Alright, I'm gonna do another M plus commentary. This is gonna be a commentary for a 23 Ruby that somewhat ended up into a somewhat into a push group, considering we were all still playing with each other. So yeah, I'll get right into it. I'm hoping I show my talents here, but I don't really know. I think I do, or I should. All right, pause, please pause, quit. No, I missed it. All right, talents for this key. I'll give you a big hint. I already have a wrong talent and I realize it midway into the key. So, talents for this, you obviously want to have spell steal so that you can spell steal the ice shields in the first area. You could spell steal in the ring area, but I don't recommend it. Although in some cases you can. And then, I'm running full AoE with Frostbite Sub-Zero. I decided not to run Snowstorm for this key, just because bosses still are a little bit sussy. But yeah. So I'm also running Time Anomaly instead of Temporal Warp, like a bad mage player, because I kind of forgot to change it. So that was an oopsies. I am not running Dragon's Breath. I decided to run Time Manipulation. I felt we had enough kicks because we have a Paladin tank, so I can kind of go into a little bit more AoE than normal. So starting this pack, Lust, you go with Frozen Orb, Blizzard, Ice Nova, and then it's just using all your procs on cooldown, and obviously sending Frozen Orb and Blizzard on cooldown. Ice Nova does have a little bit higher priority, and like I should have Ice Nova'd there instead of Frostbolted. So definitely missing out on some damage. Don't look at the damage meters, the arms is getting PI. It's broken. Not fair. PI abuser. But again, like always, just keeping up Blizzard and Frozen Orb, as is, you know, typical Frost Mage rotation. Again, I shouldn't really be casting Frostbolt in these mass AoE scenarios. I'm also, like, wasting, like, one or two globals on Frozen Orb, so definitely some room for improvement still. I am sending Unshattered Flurries, just because it is AoE. For there, you want to make sure you're interrupting every single one of the Tectonic Slams. So there, you saw me going to Melee and Blast Wave. Obviously, I'm not talented in a DB. The only thing that's a little rough with Blast Wave is if any of the targets are frozen by either Ice Nova or Frost Nova or the Frostbite talent itself, Blast Wave won't work. So it's kind of like an iffy. It's not 100% guarantee, whereas Dragon's Breath will always interrupt. So you kind of just gotta hope. You gotta pray to the RNG gods. So down here, now that it's two target, I am just setting I am shattering my Frostbolts now with Flurry. I think I do end up setting for Icy Veins here. It's not as important to have Icy Veins on pull. I'd also recommend sending Frozen Orb in this pack prior as well. If you send Frozen Orb on pull, you're most likely not going to have it back for the first whelp phase. And again, two target here, since in M+, you always, as a Frost Mage, you're always sending... you always send Blizzard when it's two targets, just based on M+ talents. I'm not positive our tank could have survived this without the priest taking the B-res, but rather safe than sorry. All So obviously just single target here. I should have sending my rune right here and my frozen orb. Okay. As I say that, I immediately send it. Glad I'm thinking into the future. Or I guess thinking into the past. Unfortunately, now this means we don't have any B-reses, so... Hey, you're not beating me anymore, thank you very much. Look at the damage meters now. Huh? Just don't look at my boss damage on this. Just don't look at the boss damage, okay? That's the one thing we're not gonna look at. So I'm pretty sure I do absolute dog water on this boss. Because you two are filthy patters on whelps. Absolute filthy patters. So every single one of the chill storms, you want to be using defenses for it. So whether that's I typically pair my defensives as barrier images or alter time for them or G invis or ice block if you really need it. But you always need to use some form of defensives. Those chill storms are very hurtful. I am saving my first frozen orb here because I know that we're getting whelps here very soon. I'm not positive still on the percentage that whelps spawn. I thought it was 75 and 50, but it seems it's more like 70 and 40. So I am using my Ice Blood Death Snare here. You know, some good old AoE pad, as of course. But I ended up using it on the boss just to make sure that I actually get the boss prio damage. But... Again, I should be popping Icy Veins here. I can throw another orb here. So in this one, you probably shouldn't do what I just did there. I blinked into a corner and then alter timed back. I probably should have just ran away and then blinked back. Because using alter time just for a positional case of Chillstorm isn't great. You should rather use it as a defensive rather than actual positioning cooldown. So now I'm saving rune here for the next whelp phase. And I think I'm going to precast Blizzard. Yeah. I should be rune of powering here. And now you can use your Ice Nova. I use Ice Nova here to shatter my Frozen Orb on all the whelps. G Invis because the Frost Overlord here is a decent chunk of AoE. And now again here, since it's more than two targets, obviously just keep up Blizzard, keep up Frozen Orb. And then after that, it's just pure single target for the rest of the boss. Like I said, for every single Chillstorm, you do want some form of defensive. For here, I get it. I just blink away, and then I think I Ice Block into it. Yeah. So obviously, I didn't alter time back. I decided I was just going to sit out. I didn't have Icy Veins rolling at the time, so I didn't think it was too much of a damage loss. Again, it's not great if you have Icy Veins rolling, but since I didn't have it rolling at the time, kind of just sitting in it didn't really affect my damage at all, because I wasn't losing Icy Veins uptime. This is where I also realized that I was running Time Anomaly instead of Temporal Warp, because I couldn't get another Lust on the boss, which was quite the oof, but yeah. As you see, I noticed that I'm running my, I'm running Time Anomaly instead of Temporal Warp. I ended up actually getting pretty good usage of it in this. I think I ended up getting like 2 minutes out of it for Hero. Which, good for me, but I mean, obviously not great for Lust, because you should be able to get more Lust timing, otherwise, but... I'm also very surprised we decided to do Dragon first without Lust. I also think in the higher key you go, I think you end up going Fire Boss and not doing Thunder Boss, because I think Rolling Thunder will end up just one-shotting you on higher keys, especially on Fort. So we'll have to see how that goes. On 23 it still seems okay, but I think when you get higher, you know, 24 or 25, I think, especially after the Fire Boss nerf near the beginning of the season, I think the Fire Boss might end up being a better choice later on. So here you can use defensives for Rolling Thunder. Obviously use them if you're the one that's that gets Rolling Thunder. Otherwise, you shouldn't really... The only damage you're really going to take is if you're close to the person who has it, or when the healer dispels it. So you can try and get as far away as possible from the people that do have it, because there is a fall-off damage. So you see the group does take a chunk of AoE damage when the healer does dispel Rolling Thunder. And you just saw it again when they dispel it again, so... Now here, my main target is always the, or at least I try main targeting the Cinder Weavers first, just because the Cinder Bolts hurt, and I'm squishy. Your main target should primarily be the Destroyer, but one thing that you also find on higher keys too, well not necessarily just on the higher keys, but I think it's actually good that the Cinder Weaver mobs, at least in these packs, get the Burning Ambition debuff. It's the one that increases their haste, but it also increases the damage they take. It's this one thing that we can spell steal, but we normally decide not to. So when, every time you get Living Bomb, you obviously want a defensive. Here I alter time. I didn't have Mirror Image. I obviously have Mirror Image still rolling, and I didn't have a barrier up, so I decided to alter time just to hit. This next pack is a pack that I would recommend, or you can actually spell steal the Burning Ambition from the Cinder Weavers. It will increase your damage and kind of just make it so the Cinder Weaver doesn't take increased damage, but at the same time, they should be dying at the same time as the Flame Dancers. I'm not sure if I actually ended up doing it on this pack or not. Yeah, I didn't end up doing. So as you see, this is the debuff here on the Primal Cinder Weaver. This is the one that you can spell steal. If I remember the numbers correctly, I believe it's 25% increased haste and a 25% damage taken increased. So obviously when you're fighting the Infernos, it's not something that I would recommend taking, because you can never avoid the Inferno cast unless you're, you know, G-invising or using defenses for it or things like that. On this pack, where there's nothing you can really take damage from, you can take it, because obviously it is a damage buff for you. I didn't end up Icy Veinsing here, because I know we're going to use it. I know we used Lust in the next pack. I probably should just send it, because I'm obviously losing some uptime here on both Rune and on Icy Veins. So again, Frost Mage, obviously the rule is, you know, don't hold your cooldowns. No, I actually am focusing the Destroyer, so that's good, but... Again, always an AoE. Always, Prio, Frozen Orb, and Blizzard up. If you can, for these Living Bombs, the Living Bombs actually interrupts spellcasts. What you saw there is it actually didn't interrupt, if I go back. We kill the one Cinder Weaver. And when it's about to go off, the mob is actually frozen by my Frostbite. So it actually doesn't work on him. It didn't interrupt his cast because he's frozen. That is one thing that will happen with Frost Mage, is a lot of your CCs, or at least like Blast Wave, and in this case the Living Bomb, won't actually interrupt the mobs because they're frozen. Dragon's Breath obviously will still, because if that's a stun and not like a knock-up or knock-away. But any mob that's frozen, it won't. I would also recommend, I think end up doing it more in the later packs, but since we have a priest, they were doing it for most of these. Any of the Flame Dancers, as soon as they are about to die, they cast the Blaze of Glory, I think is what it's called. You can spell steal those. The Blaze of Glory is what makes the AoE fire circles come down in like random spots where they're shooting fire out of them. You can spell steal that, and that a cast immediately ends. So it has no downside to you. It just makes it so that, you know, group mates might not die. I should be using Death Snare here. Yeah, I do. Use Death Snare really in any AoE pack. You should really use it on cooldown if you can. But if obviously there's a massive pack coming up, you can obviously save it for things like that. But again, I wouldn't really recommend saving Frost Mage cooldowns for any like big packs. Our main thing is just as much uptime as possible from them. So I saw I was getting Living Bomb here. I buried as my defensive. And I also got Shielded from the Priest. Nothing real special with these packs. Unfortunately, this is kind of the range that Frost Mage struggles in. All of these packs here are 3 target, which is really one of Frost's weak suits. So we really specialize in, you know, the packs near the at the very beginning and then the bosses. Considering 3 and 6 target is our weakness. Well, 3, 2, 6 target. We're obviously very good in 2 target and very good in mass AoE and very good in single target, but we really struggle in the in-between from 3 to 6. Unfortunately, these packs aren't really great for us, but we still do relatively decent damage. I would recommend getting up near these steps like I'm doing. It basically makes sure that you won't ever pull the dragon. Because if you're anywhere near the dragon's pathing, you saw him pathing up here in the top left. If you accidentally pull the dragon, it's basically a guaranteed wipe. So I would not recommend doing that. If you can just stand up by these steps, the dragon never paths anywhere up here. So you can obviously just do that, and it guarantees you're not pulling him. So you saw the living bomb. If you actually get into melee and they're not frozen, it does knock them out. Again, I alter-timed that living bomb, or the Inferno. You can alter-time Inferno, you can alter-time Living Bomb. Either of them work fine. Both very good. Obviously, just use your cycle through your defensives. Using Destiny here, I probably could have waited a second until, you know, that extra mob got in, but not too big of an issue. No real reason saving them. Again, in these packs, you can be spell stealing these Burning Ambitions because there's not Infernos. Like I said, I wouldn't recommend doing it in any of the packs where there are the major Infernos, the elemental guys on them, but any of these packs that have like the Flame Dancers that are really like just Flame Dancers or just these people, you can do it. The only thing is that really make sure that you need to get interrupting the Cinderbolt casts because, again, it does make you take increased damage. I did Spell Steal there. You can Spell Steal the Blazing Gory, like I said. Here are the typical single target rotation. I typically like baiting this first Ritual of Blaze Binding over near the steps, just personal preference. I guess I probably could have asked because like that warrior did not like me standing over there, but now once it's 2 target, you obviously want to be casting Blizzard on cooldown, especially because that'll give you your Frozen Orb more often. The main thing with this fight is you want to be baiting the Molten Boulders and the Ritual of Blaze Binding, which is the spawning of the Ad. As good as possible. If you bait any of them wrong, it really can screw the fight. So every time you're going to see the Molten Boulder, like it's going to happen right now, it ended up being baited left, which is okay. And now our Ritual of Blaze Binding is coming, so we all want to make sure we're away from all the fire as possible to bait the next ad spawn pretty well. I don't really like that ad spawn, but it's okay. And now the Molten Boulder is happening in 2 seconds. It happened on me. I baited it over to the side. Again, Blizzard should be up all the time on 2 target, and now it's just 2 target cleave for us. Again, one of Frost Mage's best suits. Molten Boulder here, baited at the side, so now it basically gives us our free rain on the whole middle. Now it's going to be another ad spawn bait. Followed by a boulder. I think I ended up baiting this boulder bad. Yep. Bad boulder bait. You really need to pay attention to those boulders because this means now we kind of have to go this way and run over here, which I'm pretty sure we do anyways, but I didn't end up holding my Frozen Orb here because I know we're going to get another ad spawn here relatively soon, so I'm kind of just I'm kind of holding my frozen orb for the next two target situation, which I wouldn't really recommend, but. Now you see me moving her here to the side. I was planning on baiting the boulder into the other corner. I would recommend using a defensive for every single Inferno that goes out. I didn't really end up using many of them, which isn't really great, but I was pretty confident in our healer. They keep me alive. It didn't seem like they had any issues. If you can, obviously have your barrier up for them, have mirror image. Anything rolling obviously helps your healer. Again, boulder baiting. I decided not to Icy Veins here because we were so close to actually killing the boss. I didn't want the downtime on Icy Veins the entire time running. Now I know we're going to get another boulder bait here, so I'm just trying to bait over here in the corner. It didn't go on me, but we ended up... We can just focus the boss anyways. They had 300k health, but... It is technically a... In that case, I didn't have... I Ice Nova'd instead of Ice Lancing or Flurrying. The boss was so low that I didn't want to basically cast a Flurry and waste a proc. For here, okay, this is my recommendation for all of this area as a Frost Mage or any mage in general. Always spell steal at least one of these Storm adds a pack. So at least from my one understanding of what these adds does is the shield that they have is a shield for 70% of their health or somewhere around there. But what happens is, so I now have the shield on me. This 2-minute shield is what happens from it. But I now lose that percentage of my health. So what can happen, which will probably end up happening, the priest will heal me back to full eventually. But I will still have that shield on me. So it basically gives me at least like 2 health bars. Especially on Fort Weeks, this is pretty important because these guys actually end up actually have a lot of health. This is very similar to the adds in the Nakud for the second boss by the Tempest. Spell stealing these for an extra shield is very beneficial. I haven't tested what happens if you spell steal more than one of them, because I know it obviously chunks your health down. But obviously just having one for every pack is very beneficial. Do you see the lightning storms happening? And I'm literally not taking damage. I'm pretty sure 2 explosives just went off too. And I still have a shield from the barrier. I'm literally just like not taking damage. So again, like I said, very beneficial to spell steal at least one of those every pack. I like doing that for, especially for the boss. I like keeping one of the side packs alive. Or at least just keeping it alive right before the boss starts, because we can, I spell steal right before the boss fight starts, and then the healer doesn't have to worry about me at all for the first few, like, interrupting spell clouds, or interrupting whatever they're called. The storm, the things that interrupt. These packs, there's not really much we can do, but I would recommend focusing the flame channelers. And obviously you need interrupts on flash fire. That's really the only thing that needs to get interrupted in these packs. The next pack's a little bit scarier because I would also recommend never spell steal this buff off the flame channeler. It basically gives it's like a 50% haste buff, but it will basically like 3-shot you. It puts a dot on you that basically just does it. At least to our health, it will basically 3-shot you, which not good. That is one of the things that is very bad to spell steal is that buff. You just have to deal with the increased haste and make sure you get off the flash fire interrupts. But they should be the first targets that are getting focused on anyways. The Storm Warriors are just tank busters. So as long as your tank can survive them, it's fine. Again, like I said, I spell stole the add in this pack. This pack always has that one in it. And so now I don't have to worry basically at all about the first lightning storm or whatever it's called. Yeah. You see, I'm still just, my shield's getting chunked, I don't know, 15%, 20% of my health every time. Just taking no damage, full health. If you do end up getting that flash fire and it doesn't get interrupted, get away from all your groupmates, because the flash fire, it basically, it heals the flame channeler as much damage as it does. So if you're in like melee and all your melee friends are getting hit, it will basically heal the flame channeler basically to full. So if you ever do get that flame channeler and you have no kicks, just get out of the group. You can always ice block, it will cancel the cast, which is good. You can GN Viz, which will reduce the healing they take, but obviously prio for interrupting is that, the flame cast. Also, the warrior question that I asked to save the guys. On this pack, there is no need to spell steal. I actually would recommend not spell stealing for this pack. What happens when the high channeler, whatever his name is, Ravati, does his Tempest Storm Shield? I'll show you the next time he does the actual cast. So he summons the Primal Thunderclouds. He's summoning them. He does Tempest Storm Shield. When the cast ends, what he does is he steals all of the shields from any mob that's around him and puts it to a shield on himself. So not only does this put it does it steal the shields from friendlies, it also steals the shields from enemies. So if you do spell steal one of these and you knock yourself down to 35% health, but you're like, oh well, I have a shield, he will steal your shield from you and then you'll just be at bare 35% health. So never spell steal the guys in this pack, at least while you're fighting this guy. Because this Tempest Storm Shield needs to get DPS through. That's the DPS check for this fight. Other than that, I would actually recommend doing AoE for these packs. Especially for these Tempest Storm Shields, because if you do damage down those shields enough, like we did on that one. Oh, I went too far ahead. We basically DPS to these shields down so low that when he finished his Tempest Storm Shield cast, it was literally just one mob's health left. I'm not sure if we MD'd or what we used here. I'm not sure if we DPS this or MD'd this down, but he literally got like no shield and immediately went into his next cast. I would recommend using defenses for almost every single one of the lightning storms that happen. Whether it's mirror image or barrier up or whatever, but always have something rolling. I did decide to hold my icy veins here because obviously the next pack is the boss. There's not really any upside to me icy veinsing here. Now this is the pack I spell steal a pack from the right side. It seems like it does do the same amount. I got knocked down to 35% every time I have spell stolen. But now again, I have that shield now for the entirety of the boss fight, or at least for 2 minutes, which is enough to go through basically the full first phase and a potential flame spit that lands on me. I should be blizzarding here. Okay, so I ended up waiting for my blizzard cast from my frozen orb, which is technically a DPS loss. If you can precast your blizzard before putting down orb, I would do that, but not too big of a deal. I did use my Iceblood Death Snare when the two were grouped together because they actually take damage when the other one takes damage. So try and do that if you can. Obviously, it's not really worth holding if you're going to hold for multiple seconds because they're not grouped, but... There is a trick for this boss, is the winds will always go in a counterclockwise manner, or you want to drop yours in a counterclockwise manner. So for this one, it's going to the left. The next one that we want to drop, you want to drop your flame spit back towards the entrance or like right here, because the winds will blow it, obviously, opposite direction. There was very scuffed. I ended up blinking across. I'll go back to it. We kind of got separated with who had what debuffs here. I think the druid didn't end up trying to, like, charge through the boss to get it as well, and I think they ended up getting hit by fire. The druid and I, who both had the positive buffs, or negative, I don't remember which is which, had the X's, and the priest was the only one with the negative, or circle. I don't remember which is which. It's whatever. I always just call it tornado and circle. But I blinked through to get hit, and the druid dashed through, or I don't know if they dashed through or got gripped through, but they got a flame circle. So, unfortunate, but... There is somewhat of a little cheese you can do on this boss, which we actually end up doing. So the bosses phase and join together when they reach 50% health. So the way you can kind of cheese it, which we somewhat do here, is if the boss lands, like, he can land at, like, 50, like, 2% or something like he did here. You actually can get this DPS for free here. Because normally they join together, he flies back to the beginning of the room at 50%. We actually ended up cheesing it a little bit and getting, you know, we got 10 extra percent here with them not being joined together. Which, this second phase is the hardest phase of the boss. It's basically where both of them, you get the interrupting storm clouds, you get 3 flame spits at the same time. So this is the most dangerous portion. So every single one of these flame spits that happens, use a defensive. Whether it's mirror image, barrier, G-Invis, ice block, anything. You need something for every single one of these. Fortified, it's not as scary, but on Tyrannical Weeks, this will absolutely truck you. Fortunately, we blasted enough that we actually only got 1 flame spit, which I was very surprised in. But, yeah. And now basically nothing happens for us for the rest of the boss fight when they're not 2 of them combined. The rest of this fight is just a tank mechanic and then a stop casting. But yeah, that's my commentary for this 23 Ruby. This group obviously is still doing some keys together. I have multiple other keys that we did with this group the rest of the week, which I'll be doing commentaries on for, you'll be seeing videos for those coming here shortly. We did this 23 Ruby, we did a 24 Temple, which I'll be doing here next, a 24 Noku, 25 Shadow Moon, 25 Court. All of these we're doing with no comms. None of us are in a Discord. It just goes to show you don't really need comms to do keys. Granted, sometimes it could be useful, but you know, if you're good players and know what's going to happen in dungeons, comms aren't really needed. As long as you have things, you know, I have interrupt trackers, well, at least somewhat of an interrupt tracker, I guarantee they all do too. If you're just cognizant of what's going to happen, it's fine to do keys without comms. Again, wouldn't really recommend it because, you know, some people actually need comms to do things, but, yeah.